Hello, good evening. Welcome to our 6 o'clock Evensong, said with hymns at St Mary's, Halesworth, this evening. We'll be using the collect and readings for Evensong on the 24th Sunday after Trinity. Rend your heart and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Our first hymn is The Day Thou Gavest, which once I've found it in the book, I'll give you a number unless you find it first. They're kind of alphabetical, but there are some. So 638 in this book, The Day Thou Gavest, Lord, is ended. 638. Are we there? The Day Thou Gavest. Beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefit that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you as many as are here present to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouth shall show forth thy praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. And so the psalm appointed this evening is number 95. And we'll read by alternate verses. I'll read the fate print. You're invited to read the bold. And we say the glory be together in conclusion. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with psalms.
For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods.
In his hands are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also.
The sea is his, and he made it. And his hands prepared the dry land.
O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
Today, if ye hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in provocation and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness.
When your fathers tempted me, proved me and saw my works.
40 years long I was aggrieved with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their hearts, for they have not known my ways.
Unto whom I swear in my wrath, that they should not enter into my rest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. We have a Hebrew scripture reading, which does go on a bit, so I suspect I'll probably find it difficult to persuade you to volunteer. So I suspect it's probably better if I read it. But you might like to have a look at the Matthew reading, which if you would be happy to read later, then that would be grand. But for the time being, here beginneth the third chapter of the book of Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits, and the breadth thereof 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather together the princes, the governors and the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counsellors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Then the princes, the governors and captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counsellors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then an herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king hath set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshippeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." Therefore at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and all kinds of music, all the people, the nations, and the languages fell down and worshipped the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Wherefore at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the King Nebuchadnezzar, "O King, live for ever. Thou, O King, hast made a decree that every man shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image, and whoso falleth not down and worshippeth, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O King, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy God, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if ye be ready, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 7 times more than it was wont to be heated. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their hosen, and their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent, and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flames of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished, and rose up in haste, and spake, and said unto his counsellors, "Did not we cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire?" They answered and said unto the king, "True, O king." He answered and said, "Lo, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the 4th is like the Son of God." Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace, and spake and said, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither." Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire. And the princes, governors, and captains, and the king's counsellors, being gathered together, saw these men upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was an hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of fire had passed on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who hath sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him, and have changed the king's word and yielded their bodies, that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore I make a decree that every people, nation, language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. Here endeth the first lesson. And so we turn to the Magnificat, which we'll say by alternate verses. My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. For behold, from henceforth, all generations shall call me blessed.
For he that is mighty hath magnified me, and holy is his name.
And his mercy is on them that fear him throughout all generations.
He hath shown strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts.
He hath put down the mighty from their seat, and hath exalted the humble and meek.
He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away.
He, remembering his mercy, hath holpen his servant Israel, as he promised to our forefathers Abraham and his seed for ever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And so, are you up for the second lesson? Thank you.
It begins the 24th verse of the 13th chapter of Matthew. Another parable he put forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? He said unto them, An enemy hath done this. The servants said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you also root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Another parable he put forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. But when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. Another parable spake he unto them, The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took, and hid in three measures of meal, till the whole was leavened. All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. Then Jesus sent the multitude away, and went into the house. And his disciples came unto him, saying, Declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. He answered and said unto them, He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom. But the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Here endeth the second lesson.
Thank you. So we say the Nunc Dimittis by alternate verses. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word.
For mine eyes have seen thy salvation,
which thou hast prepared before the face of all people,
to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with thy spirit. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us, and grant us thy salvation. O Lord, save the Queen, and mercifully hear us when we call upon thee. Endue thy ministers with righteousness, and make thy chosen people joyful. O Lord, save thy people, and bless thine inheritance. Give peace in our time, O Lord, because there is none other that fighteth for us, but only thou, O God. O God, make clean our hearts within us, and take not thy Holy Spirit from us. O Lord, we beseech thee, absolve thy people from their offences, that through thy bountiful goodness we may all be delivered from the bands of those sins which by our frailty we have committed. Grant this, O Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our blessed Lord and Saviour. Amen. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we come to our next hymn, which as I look it up, I'll let you know what that's going to be. Jesus shall reign where'er the sun. So again, I'm confident it's in here, but exactly where it is. 359. 359. Jesus shall reign where'er the sun. Are we there?
Yeah.
Jesus shall reign wherever the sun does his successive journeys from. His kingdom stretched from shore to shore, till moon shall wax and wane no more. People and realms of every tongue dwell on his love with sweetest song, and infant voices shall proclaim their earthly blessings on his name. Blessings abound where'er he reigns, the prisoners leap to lose their chains, the weary find eternal rest, and all the humble poor are blessed. Shall endless prayer be made, and praises throng to crown his head. His name like incense shall arise with every morning sacrifice. Let every creature rise and bring peculiar honors to our King. Angels descend with songs again, and earth repeat the loud Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our psalm this evening is also known as the Venite, and it opens Friday morning prayers in common worship as the Canticle. And it's an exhortation to praise the Lord. It's an encouragement to do so with a reason for encouraging us. As we move through the psalm, we read, "If you hear God's voice, harden not your hearts." That might be an instruction, it might be a statement of fact, that as we are open to the voice of God, our hearts will not become hardened. I suppose it's the same as in any relationship, at work or at home. The more time we spend with the person we are with, attentively listening, open and with respect towards them, our relationship will grow and flourish. But if we turn away, if we ignore them, it will wither and dry out. And in our psalm we hear that God is grieved, chillingly, with the people that he was leading in the wilderness. Let us heed the psalmist and come heartily rejoicing in the strength of God's salvation. If we needed a practical example of how strong that salvation is and how treacherous it is for us to trust in what our government presents us with as a framework of trust and security. We may trust in our military, we may trust in a vaccine, we may trust in an economic policy, we may trust in our own strength, or in a philosophy that we or others have contrived. But if we look at our first reading from the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego trusted in their God. They were open to God's voice. They had not hardened their hearts. And so when they were told to bow the knee to the state, they did not. Daniel was written at a time of persecution. I'm afraid I'm not sufficiently up on my Hebrew history to know whether it was the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, the Persians, but I think it was at the time of the Maccabean rebellion. And this was written in this coded bedtime story, repetitive style, that we may remember the various treasurers, counselors, sheriffs. We may remember the list of musical instruments. We may remember the names Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego as flags, as drumbeats, as trumpet calls, that when we are tempted to bow the knee to false gods of our own or others, to submit to the instructions of the states that persecute and oppress us, that we will not, even if we are thrown into the burning fiery furnace. Intriguingly, the king does a U-turn, and rather than seeking to put them to death, honours those three and makes them second only to him in the kingdom. And whereas he had decreed that they should be put to death, he issues a decree that those who don't believe in their God may suffer a dissimilar fate, but nevertheless a death sentence. And whilst that might be a particularly gloomy and dark and wrathful reason to follow God and be open to God's voice and message, our second reading or second lesson from Matthew has a more positive reason. The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which someone took and sowed in the field. It's a small seed, a small thing, but when it is left in the ground, it grows, becoming the greatest among herbs, a tree, no less, that birds of the air may come and lodge within it. As we turn to God and open our hearts, minds, eyes, and ears, not only will we be saved from persecution, according to our first reading, but also the rule of God, that which God longs for in our lives and in our community, will grow, such that those who are homeless, such that our environment, our wildlife, will thrive and flourish. Others that are open to other things may allow that which is negative, death-bringing, painful and hurting to grow in their lives. But we are told that God will resolve all these things in the end, removing that which is negative and hurtful and painful, and restoring only that which is fruitful and right and good. Intriguingly, we are told that Jesus only speaks in parables, lest we understand. I will utter these things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. Only those that turn and believe fully understand what it is that God is saying to us. I know from my experience that as I learn more about God, the more scripture makes sense. And we must be prepared that those who read scripture afresh, without having any instruction or understanding, will find it baffling and off-putting. May we turn to God with open hearts and minds, that God's rule may grow and flourish in us, that we will not find ourselves persecuted, and that others around and about us, who need to know how valued and important they are, will begin to learn that and know God walking with them in the flames that perturb and disturb them, that they may be brought out of their fiery furnace, out of that field of wheat and tares, and restored to the people that they should be in God. Amen. And so to our next hymn, number 262, Happy Are They That Love God. Number 262. For me, as I might have hoped. But, we don't have the dots in our books, so. But well done all for bearing with us. Let us pray. God, who art nigh to all them that call upon thee in truth, who art thyself the truth, whom to know is life eternal, instruct us with thy divine wisdom and teach us thy law, that we may know the truth and walk in it. Through him in whom the truth was made manifest, even Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord. Amen. Worthy of praise from every mouth, of confession from every tongue, of worship from every creature, is thy glorious name, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who didst create the world by the word of thy power, and in love didst wonderfully redeem it. Wherefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we adore and magnify thy holy name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed Lord, who thyself didst undergo the pain and suffering of the cross, uphold, we beseech thee, with thy promised gift of strength, all those of our brethren who are suffering for their faith in thee, that from their steadfastness thy church may grow in grace, and we ourselves increase in perseverance to the honour of thy holy name, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit art ever one God, world without end. Amen. We take a minute of silence to bring our own petitions to the throne of the heavenly grace. Almighty God, who hast given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost together in thy name, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come life everlasting. Amen. And so we come to our final hymn. Easier to find and easier to sing, no doubt. Number 2, Abide With Me. Number 2, Abide With Me.
Tears no bitterness. triumph still if thou abide with me. Hold thou thy cross before my closing eyes, guide through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's vain shadows flee. In life, in death, O Lord, abide with me.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen.